Inner Traditions Audio presents The Cygnus Key, The Denisovan Legacy, Göbekli Tepe, and the Birth of Egypt by Andrew Collins, read by Micah Hanks. Preface: Last of the Denisovans. The date is approximately 45,000 years ago. The location, a mountain pass somewhere in the Altai-Sayan region of southern Siberia. From a rocky vantage point, four tall, darkened forms emerge into view from behind a patch of cold early morning mist. They stand a few meters apart, gazing toward the only path permitting access to the mountain's central plateau. Each figure is of extraordinary size, being as much as 7 feet in height. Their stature is that of giant wrestlers, their enormous frames accentuated by broad shoulders and streams of furs that immerse their bodies from head to feet. Their heads are also of incredible size, being both long and broad, with large, powerful jaws. What little can be seen of their exposed skin suggests it is brown, their long, matted hair either dark or the color of straw. Adding to the almost alien appearance of these strange individuals are their extremely large noses and unusual eyes, which have striking black pupils and irises so pale they seem almost white. Completing the picture are the long, dark feathers attached to their furs, which blow about in the gentle breeze that has followed the first light of day. They are Denisovans, members of an archaic human population whose very existence had gone unrecognized until the first decade of the 21st century, when oversized fossil remains were discovered in a large cave in the Altai Mountains of southern Siberia. The purpose of these four figures at the head of this rocky pass is to await the arrival of others, a new people from a distant land located in the direction of the setting sun. In small groups, these people have been approaching ever nearer to the Denisovans' mountain retreats, and now, finally, they were within sight, moving slowly toward the Denisovans' elevated position. These intruders were shorter and more slightly built, their heads smaller and more elongated. Furthermore, their approach to life seemed quite different. They enter new territories, assume control of them, and exploit their natural resources before dispatching some of their growing number in pursuit of even more suitable places of occupation. They have been advancing in this manner for several thousand years, encountering and even interbreeding with the old people of the West, who will one day become known as Neanderthals. For countless millennia, the old people have occupied vast swathes of the western Eurasian continent, while the Denisovans have been content to remain in the eastern part of the continent. Now, finally, the new people had arrived in the Altai-Sayan region and were about to encounter a small group of Denisovans for the very first time. Their advance party was perhaps 10 to 12 in number. They, too, wore furs to combat the colder climate found at these higher altitudes, and in the hands of some of them were long wooden spears. One, the leader of the group, was brandishing his weapon in a provocative manner, as if ready to attack at the first sign of aggression from the tall strangers. Yet the Denisovans say and do nothing. They simply stand their ground, gazing down at the intruders, who are now shuffling to a halt no more than 15 meters away. The leader of the new people seems unsure what to do. Should they advance farther and strike out at these people who look like tree trunks? Why did they not attack? More pressingly, why did they not carry weapons? What strange magic was this? Were they powerful shamans who did not need weapons? Could they kill simply by making eye contact? Could they send out spirits to torment the families of intruders? The Denisovans were indeed powerful shamans. They knew that any confusion or uncertainty in the minds of the new people would cause them to question their actions. What is more, the plan was working. They approached no farther. A few final thrusts into the air of the leader's spear did nothing to prompt a response from the Denisovans, who simply stood their ground, unfazed by what was unfolding in front of them. Unnerved and fearful of their enemy's powerful magic, the new people all at once turn around and retreat back down the mountain pass and out of sight. The Denisovans have won the day. Yet they know full well that eventually the new people will return, this time in much greater numbers. Eventually, the intruders will overrun the Denisovans' world, spelling an end to their population. It might take a few decades, a few centuries, or even a few millennia, but it will happen. In the future, the preservation of the Denisovans' profound ancient wisdom, accumulated across hundreds of generations, will become the property of the new people. It will be through them that the Denisovans will continue to exist. Yet this will not happen through conquest or submission, but through interbreeding. The last of the Denisovans will give way to hybrid descendants, who with an entirely revitalized mindset will continue to thrive, not just in the old world, but also in the far-off American continent. Sadly, however, the Denisovans were aware also that for many millennia, knowledge of their very existence will be suppressed, belittled, and finally forgotten. Yet one day, as the prophecies determine, they will rise again, their contribution to the genesis of civilization laid bare for all to see. Then, finally, everyone will know the legacy of the Denisovans. This is an imagined first meeting between anatomically modern humans, Homo sapiens, and the last of the Denisovans, tentatively Homo sapiens altaiensis. It is based on what meager evidence we have regarding their physiognomy, behavior, genetics, and technological achievements, along with local folklore, which perhaps preserves a memory of their former existence in the region. Whatever the accuracy behind this all-important encounter between our own ancestors and the Denisovans, the chances are it occurred around 45,000 years ago, either in the Altai Mountains, where their fossil remains have been found in the Denisova Cave, the type site of the Denisovans, or a little further north in the western Sayan Mountains. A type site is a site that is considered to be the model of a particular archaeological culture. These straddle the republics of Kakassia and Tuva, between which is a narrow strip of land constituting the most southerly part of the Russian province of Krasnoyarsk Krai. Here, age-old folk stories speak of the former presence of a giant population that inhabited the nearby Yenisei and Abakan river basins. They recall how these giants, referred to in Kakassia as the Ak-Karak, the white-eyed people, created the first stone fortresses, kurgans, the first irrigation channels, the first dams and bridges, and even the first divine melodies played on musical instruments. The description of these legendary giants best fits what we know about the Denisovans, who occupied southern Siberia for hundreds of thousands of years before their disappearance around 40,000 years ago. DNA analysis of many modern populations in East Asia, South Asia, Indonesia, Australia, and even Melanesia and Micronesia tell us that Denisovans interbred with the earliest modern humans who passed through their territories. More significantly, there is every reason to link the Denisovans with the sudden acceleration in human behavior known to have occurred in southern Siberia between 20,000 and 45,000 years ago. This included the making of some of the first bird bone flutes anywhere in the world, along with the creation of settled habitation sites, the employment of advanced hunting techniques, the formalizing of toolkits, including the use of microblade technology, and the first sustained appearance of a specialized form of stone tool production known as pressure flaking. In addition to this, there is compelling evidence that the earliest human societies to occupy the Altai-Sayan region possessed an extraordinary knowledge of long-term eclipse cycles. Evidence suggests they used a knowledge of these cycles to develop complex, numerically based calendrical systems that would go on to permeate religious cosmologies in many parts of the ancient world. All the indications are that this grand calendrical system, as we shall call it, had its inception in southern Siberia and might well have been inherited from the lost world of the Denisovans. There are also tantalizing clues that the principal creative influence seen as responsible for long-term time cycles and the inaudible sounds once thought to be emitted by the sun, moon, and stars was identified with a cosmic bird symbolized in the night sky by the stars of Cygnus, the celestial swan. Through this association, the constellation went on to become guardian of the entrance to the sky world, through which human souls had to pass either to achieve incarnation or to enter the afterlife. In time, many of the technological, cultural, and cosmological achievements that appear first in southern Siberia, circa 20,000 to 45,000 years ago, reach the pre-pottery Neolithic world of southeast Anatolia and begin to flourish at key cult centers such as Göbekli Tepe. From here, they are carried southward through the Levant to northern Egypt, on the banks of the Nile River, as early as 8,500 to 8,000 BCE, they find a new home at a site named Helwan, which is today a thriving industrial city immediately south of Cairo. Yet it was here, almost certainly, that the pre-dynastic world of ancient Egypt would begin in earnest, and it would be just across the river, on the plateau at Giza, that the fruits of the Denisovan legacy would finally find manifestation in the greatest and most enigmatic architectural accomplishment of the ancient world, the Great Pyramid, built for the pharaoh Khufu circa 2550 BCE. As we shall see, its underlying geometry, which underpins the entire pyramid field at Giza, displays a profound knowledge of long-term time cycles, numeric systems, and sound acoustics, as well as a polar-centric cosmology featuring the stars of Cygnus. All of this might well have had its origins in southern Siberia as much as 45,000 years ago. Piecing this story together will require some patience. Yet those who persevere will discover not only tantalizing evidence of a lost civilization, but also the true founders of our own. Part 1. Göbekli Tepe. Chapter 1. An Artist's Work. It was found during routine excavations at the site of Göbekli Tepe, the most extraordinary megalithic temple complex in the world. Yet no one could have quite realized just how important the tiny bone plaque would be to our knowledge of the beliefs, practices, and sophistication of the pre-pottery Neolithic world of Southeast Anatolia some 11,000 years ago. Archaeologists and other specialized teams of scientists have been investigating Göbekli Tepe since 1995. What they have found has changed the way we view the emergence of high culture and even of civilization itself. So far, several major enclosures containing rings of T-shaped standing stones, set up like spokes of a wheel around a pair of much larger monoliths, have been uncovered at the site. Each one is magnificent in its style and design, with exquisite carved decorations on many of the stones that speak volumes about the level of sophistication and technological advancement of their builders, who emerged on the scene as if out of nowhere. End of the Ice Age. The oldest enclosures at Göbekli Tepe are around 11,500 years old. Indeed, construction at the site probably began within a generation or so of the end of the last Ice Age, which had given way to a sudden increase in temperature about 15,000 years ago. This had lasted for around 2,000 years, until approximately 10,800 BCE, when there was a rapid resurgence of the ice sheets, which had been withdrawing gradually before this time. This had brought back severe Arctic conditions across large areas of the Northern Hemisphere, creating a mini ice age that lasted around 1,200 years, and then abruptly halted, circa 9,600 BCE. This is known to paleoclimatologists as the Younger Dryas event. It was shortly after this time that the first colossal stone structures were built on this remote mountaintop in southeast Anatolia. The earliest monuments at Göbekli Tepe were constructed by an advanced prehistoric society, officially classified as hunter-gatherers, since there was no animal husbandry or wide-scale cultivation of cereal crops at this time. Both came only after Göbekli Tepe had been up and running for at least half a millennium. During this time, further stone enclosures were being built either alongside or on top of their predecessors, until finally, around 8,000 BCE, Göbekli Tepe was abandoned. All remaining enclosures were buried beneath thousands of tons of earth, rubble, stone chippings, and human refuse. Thereafter, the communities brought together to take part in this mammoth building project, which had lasted approximately 1,500 years, dispersed into other parts of the ancient world, carrying with them new ideas in domesticated agriculture, stone technologies, engineering, and arguably even the brewing of beer and making of wine. The achievements of the Göbekli builders remained hidden beneath the occupational mound, or tepe, Turkish for hill, usually a former occupational mound, until 1994, when the late Professor Klaus Schmidt, a German archaeologist with the University of Heidelberg and the German Archaeological Institute, arrived at the site. He saw the tops of stones peeking out of the fertile earth, as well as fragments of carved stone scattered about the surface of the mound, used today for cultivation purposes. Their great age was made clear by the presence of countless stone tools and projectile points across a wide area. These could accurately be dated to the pre-pottery Neolithic age, meaning that many of them were as much as 10,000 to 11,000 years old. The following year, 1995, excavations began at the site. These have continued through till the present day, with new discoveries being made every year. In addition to the stone enclosures, archaeologists have uncovered a number of portable objects, including carved statues of animals and human figures, as well as a whole series of small items fashioned from hard stone. They include perforated beads and buttons, along with various holed pendants bearing abstract images of snakes, birds, and other creatures of the natural world. Discovery of the bone plaque. Among the portable items found at Göbekli Tepe in 2011 was the aforementioned bone plaque, which is just 6 centimeters in length, 2.5 centimeters in width, and 3 to 4 millimeters in thickness. Its smooth surface, which appears highly polished, bears etched carvings, although only on one side. The other side is blank. After discovery, the object was cleaned, recorded, and placed in storage. With the opening of a new archaeological museum in Şanlıurfa, Turkey, in May 2015, the tiny bone plaque was displayed for the first time. Although experts had obviously noticed that it bears some minute etchings, no consensus opinion had been reached on what they might represent. This task was left to Matthew Smith, a British expat telephone engineer then living in Turkey.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.